Go.
In this video, I'll be reviewing the systemic circulation of the digestive organs in the abdominal pelvic cavity. And this is referred to as the splanchnic circulation. So this is a specific systemic circulation. So it starts at the left ventricle and ends at the right atrium, as I've indicated for you here. Now, between the left ventricle and what I've drawn here, I've skipped a couple of steps, so let's just remind ourselves. From the left ventricle, blood would be ejected through the aortic valve into the ascending aorta, go through the aortic arch, through the thoracic aorta, and what I've drawn for you here is the abdominal section of the aorta. Okay, now this model is also showing the abdominal section of the aorta, and we can see the three main vessels that are associated with the splanchnic circulation, arterial vessels. Now, just a reminder, or just kind of a little frame of reference as we're getting into this, we've gotten used to the idea of bilateral symmetry and right and left versions of vessels. But I'm going to turn this model sideways because if we're looking at the aorta and the inferior vena cava here, they would be close to the vertebral column. And that means that the abdominal pelvic cavity is going to be essentially where I'm kind of circling my hand right now. Okay, so it doesn't really make sense for arteries to be coming to the left and to the right here to supply those organs. It makes sense for arteries to be coming off the anterior surface of the abdominal aorta in order to direct blood to those organs. And that's exactly what we have here. We have three unpaired arteries that deliver blood to our abdominal pelvic organs. Okay? And so I'm going to put this model down and switch back to the board so that I can write the names of those arteries up here for you. Okay, so the artery that is closest to the diaphragm is the celiac trunk. The artery that is next, kind of in order as we're going inferiorly along the abdominal aorta, is the superior mesenteric artery. And then the one that is closest to where the abdominal aorta splits into the common iliac arteries is the inferior mesenteric artery. Okay, and as I said, there's no left or right versions because there's only one of each of these vessels. Now, these vessels, when a person is at rest and not digesting, should receive about 25% of a person's cardiac output. So that's a significant amount, and that's why anytime there's any sort of intra-abdominal hemorrhaging, it's considered a life-threatening situation. Okay, now we're using red for this, which is our color to indicate that the blood coming through these vessels is oxygen rich. Okay? And since it's part of our systemic circulation, it is going to have nutrients and other substances in it, but there's not going to be an excessive amount. It's going to be what we would say maybe nutrient typical. Okay? Now that's going to change as this blood goes through the digestive organs. Now, I am not putting details up here as far as which of these vessels directs blood to each individual alimentary organ in the abdominal cavity. That's kind of beyond the scope of this course. I will tell you that if you got into a more detailed study, you would find that there are specific pathways to specific organs. We're not going to go to that level. We're just going to kind of collectively consider all the digestive organs together in the abdominal pelvic cavity, and we're going to kind of sum up that these three vessels collectively are delivering that oxygen-rich, nutrient-typical blood to these organs. Okay, now as the blood is passing through these organs, it's going to be going through capillary beds, and as it's passing through those capillary beds in the organ walls, this is where we're going to have exchanges taking place. Okay, so oxygen is going to leave the blood, CO2 is going to enter the blood, and in many places, we're also going to have nutrients entering the blood. Okay, because remember that especially as blood is going through the small intestine, we're doing absorption. Okay, so the end products of chemical digestion, those small organic molecules, are going to be entering along with vitamins, minerals, etc. Okay, so the blood that is leaving the digestive organs is going to be oxygen poor, but it's going to be nutrient rich. Okay, and it's going to have more nutrients in it than we would have in typical systemic blood. So we're going to have to direct this blood to a location where those nutrients can be processed. Okay, and that location that we're going to direct the blood to is the liver, and the vessel that is going to collect the blood and carry it to the liver is the hepatic portal vein. Okay, and I'm trying to indicate over here that there are other veins that would be draining blood from the digestive organs that are going to kind of coalesce and come together to form the hepatic portal vein, and that hepatic portal vein is then going to direct blood into the liver. Okay? As the blood goes through the liver, and we'll talk about this in more detail in another video, the nutrients are going to be processed and other changes will happen to the blood. Okay? Once the blood is leaving the liver, it's typical systemic circulation blood. Okay, so that's why we're switching back to blue to represent this. Okay, and there will be a set of vessels that will carry blood away from the liver. And I've made them longer than they actually are for the purposes of this video. These are the hepatic veins. Okay, and these veins, we're using blue again. So this is our typical systemic circulation venous blood, oxygen poor, and back to nutrient typical, no longer nutrient enriched. Okay, and this is going to allow blood, these hepatic veins are going to allow blood to enter the inferior vena cava, and the inferior vena cava is then connected to the right atrium. Okay, so this is the special systemic circulation for the alimentary canal organs in the abdominal cavity, the splanchnic circulation.